ready?
जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवरदारी यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरा वनचारी यमुना तीरा वनचारी जाया राधा माधवा कुंज बिहारी हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे 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 रामा राम रामा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे हरि बोल हरि बोल नित्य गौर हरि बोल पावन हरिनाम संकीर्तन की श्रील प्रभुपाद की ग्रंथरा श्रीमद्भागवतम की ओम अज्ञानतिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुवन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वंदेहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरोन्वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च नमावों विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादि पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. Sound is clear? Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayamudiraye Nashtaprayeshva Bhadresha Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavatyuttamashloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishthiki Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya Cha Nanda Gopak Kumaraya Govindaya Namo Namaha. We are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, 4th canto, 31st chapter, text number 11. Shrute natapasa vakyam vacho vischitta vritti vihi buddhya vakyam nipunaya balinendriya radhasa shrute natapasa vakyam vacho vischitta vritti vihi buddhya vakyam nipunaya Balanendriya Radhasa Shrutena Tapasa Vakyam Vacho Vischitta Vritti Vihi Buddhya Vakyam Nipunaya Balanendriya Radhasa. Shrutena Tapasa Vakyam Vacho vischitta vritti vihi Buddhya vakim nipunaya Balanendriya radhasa Shrutena tapasa vakyam Vacho vischitta vritti vihi Buddhya vakim nipunaya Balanendriya radhasa. Shrutena, by Vedic education. Tapasa, by austerities. Va, or, kim, what is the meaning? Vachobihi, by words. Chitta, of consciousness. Vrittibihi, by the occupations. Buddhya, by intelligence. Va, or, kim, what is the use? Nipunaya, expert. Balena, by bodily strength. Indriya Radhasa, by the power of the senses. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Asi Bhaktivedanta Swami, Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki, without devotional service, what is the meaning of severe austerities? The process of hearing, the power of speech, the power of mental speculation, elevated intelligence, strength and the power of senses. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. From the Upanishads, Mundaka Upanishad, we learn Nayam Atma Pravachanena Labhyo Na Medhayana Bahuna Shrutena Yamye Vaishavrinate Tena Labhya Tasyaisha Atma Vibrinate Tanum Swam. Our relationship with the Supreme Lord is never advanced by simple study of the Vedas. There are many Mayavadi sannyasis fully engaged in studying the Vedas, Vedanta Sutra and Upanishads, but unfortunately they cannot grasp the real essence of knowledge. In other words, they do not know the Supreme Personality of Godhead. What then is the use in studying all the Vedas if one cannot grasp the essence of the Vedas? Krishna, the Lord confirms in Bhagavad Gita 15:15, Vedaischa Sarvair Ahameva Vedyaha. By all the Vedas, I am to be known. Then there are many religious systems wherein penances and austerities are greatly stressed. But at the end, no one understands Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. There is therefore no point in such penance tapasya. If one has actually approached the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he does not need to undergo severe austerities. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is understood through the process of devotional service. In the 9th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, devotional service is explained as Rajaguhyam, the king of all confidential knowledge. There are many good writers of Vedic literatures and they recite works such as the Ramayana, Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita. Sometimes these professional readers manifest very good scholarship and exhibit word jugglery. Unfortunately, they are never devotees of the Supreme Lord. Consequently, they cannot impress upon the audience the real essence of knowledge, Krishna. There are also many thoughtful writers and creative philosophers. But despite all their learning, if they cannot approach the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they are simply useless mental speculators. There are many sharply intelligent people in this material world and they discover so many things for sense gratification. They also analytically study all the material elements. But despite their expert knowledge and expert scientific analysis of the whole cosmic manifestation, their endeavors are useless because they cannot understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As far as our senses are concerned, there are many animals, both beasts and birds, who are very expert in exercising their senses more keenly than human beings. For example, the vultures or hawks can go very high in the sky but can see a small body on the ground very clearly. This means that their eyesight is so keen that they can find an eatable corpse from a great distance. Certainly, their eyesight is much keener than human beings. But this does not mean that their existence is more important than that of a human being. Similarly, dogs can smell many things from a far distance. Many fish can understand by the power of sound that an enemy is coming. All these examples are described in Srimad Bhagavatam. If one's senses cannot help him attain the highest perfection of life, realization of the Supreme, they are all useless. We are reading from the chapter, Narada instructs the Prachetas. Narada is asking them, Shrutena tapasa vakyam. Shrutena means by Vedic education or by tapasya. What is the use of Vedic education or tapasya? Vacho vis chitta vritti bihi. If somebody can be a great writer or a creative philosopher or an intelligent scientist, or a professional reader of Srimad Bhagavatam. Vachobhis chitta vritti bhi, or mental speculator. Buddhya vakyam nipunaya. If somebody is a very great person with expert intelligence, like the scientists who have discovered many things, Balanendri Radhasa, or like the animals and birds, Prabhupada said, they have the power of the senses. Eagle can have a telescopic eye from the sky. To see a dead corpse below, or a dog can smell and find out a thief, or a fish can sense the danger coming from 10 miles behind. It can sense that there is a big fish coming to swallow him. So what is the use of such power of senses? So in all these cases, Srila Prabhupada makes a point, as you all observed just now. Prabhupada says that what is the use if they don't come to the right conclusion, which is Vedaischa Sarvai Ahameva Vedyo Vedantakrit Vedavideva Chaham. Sometimes when devotees hear such kinds of verses like this, it makes them feel, that is true, we don't need austerities, we don't need Vedic study, Naham Veda, Na Tapasa, Na Dhanena, we don't have to give charity also, Nacha Ijaya, so we don't have to worship the Lord also. So it's very easy to give up these things. But then Krishna says, Bhaktiya tu ananyaya shakya ahamevam vidho Arjuna jnatam drashtum cha tatvena praveshtum cha parantapa. He says, Arjuna, The only thing that satisfies me is bhakti. So sometimes even an average devotee may miss out that point. We may sometimes think that, oh, Krishna says austerity is useless. Aham Veda, Na Tapasa. So we don't have to be a great scholar. We don't have to study the books nicely. We don't have to do great austerities. People think like that. Actually, that's not the point. The point is, if somebody is doing Vedic study, or a great philosopher, or a great writer, creative writer, thinker, or a scientist, if they come to the end conclusion, which is, Krishna is all that is, Vasudeva Sarvamiti, then they are perfect, otherwise not. Let us take one of these items, say austerity. So why do people perform austerity? If you see, in the Mahabharata, you know Jayadrath? Jayadrath was passing through a jungle with 1,000 people, you know, going with him. He was in a chariot and many foot soldiers were walking, and along with his son also. And then suddenly when he turned to the side in the woods, he saw a beautiful blackish woman, a dark beauty. He saw in the woods sparkling eyes. So he wanted to find out who it was, and then he went there, and then it was Draupadi. And in the course of his talking, he became fascinated by her beauty. He tried to kidnap her. Later on, all the Pandavas returned back and attacked him and defeated him thoroughly. He was brought down on his hands and knees. And Bhima put him at the feet of Yudhishthira Maharaj. As usual, Yudhishthira Maharaj was very merciful. He told him, "You see, my dear king, you are weak, but you have made an effort to usurp another man's wife. Never do such a thing in future. Lead a noble life. Walk the righteous path. I bless you that you will have a good future." Like that, Yudhishthira Maharaj spoke and sent him off. Now when Jayadrath left that place, in his mind he thought, these Pandavas can never be conquered by war or by my muscle power. It's just not possible. If you have to win them, I have to get some extra power. So then he went to forest and he performed severe penances to Lord Shiva, eating only leaves. And for several months, he performed very severe penance. Practically, he became emaciated skin. Then by his penance, Lord Shiva was pleased. And Lord Shiva appeared in front of him, asking, "Yes, my son, how can I please you? What do you want? What are you looking for?" So he told Shiva that, "Please give me weapons and a strength by which I can kill all the Pandavas. I can destroy all the Pandavas," he said. Shiva said, "You are asking for the impossible. You know, the Pandavas are protected by Krishna and they cannot be killed. Nevertheless, because you have a desire to subdue them, I can give you a power that you will be able to keep them in bay in the war. Four of the Pandavas, other than Arjuna, because Arjuna is non-different from Nara, out of the Naranarayan Rishi. So he's extremely powerful. So leaving Arjuna aside, other four Pandavas, you can keep them in bay. That kind of, on one day you can do that. That power I can give you." After saying this, Lord Shiva vanished. But why did I tell you this? Jayadratha is doing austerity to take revenge. That is the point. Jayadratha is doing austerity to gain some power, to become better than someone else, to apply it for an evil purpose. So to do austerity is to gain some powers for evil purpose or for taking revenge. You know, then a person remains on the material platform. Then what is the use of such an austerity? Another example let us take from Ramayana. In Ramayana, you know, there was a great ascetic and a person who used to regularly read the Vedic literature. His name is Vishrava. He's an ascetic. He's like a rishi. He married the daughter of Bharadwaj Muni. And Bharadwaj, and in Bharadwaj Muni's daughter, after marriage, he begot a very glorious son called Vaishravana. Vaishravana is none other than Kubera, who is the treasurer of the demigods. Illustrious son. So, later on, at one time, what happened was, the demigods and demons had a big fight, and the fight became very terrible, and Lord Vishnu immediately came there, and he alighted the war, he stopped the war. And then the demons fled to the Netherlands, that means lower planets, they went back. But there was one demon called Sumali who remained on earth only. He was just roaming around. He didn't go back. So when one day the Sumali saw this Vaishravana or Kubera, he was flying on a Pushpaka Viman plane up in the sky. So he looked at the plane and immediately a thought came in his mind. He thought he is Vishrava's son. So these devatas are all flourishing. I should do some good for the asuras also. Thinking like this, he went home. He called his young daughter, Kaikashi. He told Kaikashi that, oh my daughter, by now I should have got you married. You are not yet married, so I would like to see you settled. I suggest you that you should approach this Vishrava. He's a great ascetic and a great sage. You know, he has produced such a powerful, glorious son like Kubera. So if you marry him, you will also get very powerful sons. So she was very happy. So she went to the ashram, outside the ashram, in the forest under a tree. Vishrava was sitting in meditation. So she went and stood before him, putting her head down and scratching the ground. When Vishrava opened the eyes, he asked her, oh, beautiful lady, what can I do for you? What do you expect from me? So she said, I am too shy to tell you. But I, you know, you great ascetics like you can understand my mind, she said. He said, oh, I understand. He thought for a moment and then he said, you desire sons from me. Definitely I can marry you and I can give sons for you. The only problem is you have approached me at an inauspicious time. So because of this, you will get sons who are very cruel in nature, very fierce in their looks, and they'll be taken to the misdeeds. And they'll be a source of trouble for others. Like that he said. So when she heard it, she cried and said, no, 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 that's not what I expected from you. I want good sons, she said. And then he said, because you have a desire to have virtuous sons, I can't take this back because you arrived at an inauspicious hour. So bad sons will be born, but your last son will be virtuous, don't worry. And then he gave her children. So the first son was Dashagriva. So when this Dashagriva was born, following him, there was Kumbhakarna. Following him was Shurpanaka. Then following him was Vibhishan. Totally four children. So one of the days, when this Dashagriva, when he appeared, there were so many bad omens. Blood was pouring down from the sky. And the asuras were emanating fire from their mouths and screaming in the skies. And all kinds, and all the ocean waves were raising sky high. And the meteors were falling down. There were a lot of bad omens like that. And people could hear sounds of screaming and yelling. And all the demigods were horrified seeing that when Dashagriva appeared. Now his mother, Kaikashi, just look at her, how the mind works. She called Dashagriva and said, you see, Dashagriva, look at your cousin brother. Look at your brother, Kubera. He is shining with so much opulence. You know, what are you in comparison to him? Go to forest and exert yourself and gain some powers. Do something great. Like that she said. He told the mother, Mother, don't worry. I will perform such austerities where I will not only become equal to him, I will even exceed him in power and opulence. Like that he said. And Dashagriva went to perform penance for Lord Brahma. Then his other brothers, all people followed also. Of course, when Vibhishan appeared as a child, there were flowers falling from the sky and all the devatas reverberated. They chanted many mantras, auspicious mantras, when Vibhishan appeared. So, now when they all performed penance in the forest, when Brahma descended, this Dashagriva asked him that, I want a power in such a way that nobody should be able to kill me. And he only didn't ask about the humans and animals, that's all. Because he thought they are too useless to think about also. It's a waste of time. So he told all other names. I should not be killed by Gandharvas, Kinnaras, or this or that. So many all other categories. So he was given that benediction. And when Kumbhakarna, he finished his penance, when Brahma came, then all the devatas came to Brahma and folded the palms and said, Oh Lord Brahma, this is a very dangerous fellow. As soon as he was born, already he came to heaven. He swallowed 7 apsaras. He also swallowed 10 attendants of Indra and many other onlookers in the assembly of Indra. Now everybody is horrified by hearing the name of Kumbhakarna also. So please do something by which you will not give any deadly benediction to him. And Brahma smiled and said, don't worry. He requested Saraswati that you twist his tongue in such a way that he will speak something which will bring auspiciousness to all the devatas. So by Saraswati's arrangement, Kumbhakarna ended up asking that please give me adequate time for sleeping. Like that he asked. Brahma said, so be it. 6 months you will sleep and wake up only for a day. Again you will sleep for 6 more months. Like that he told him. So all devatas were very happy. And when the turn came to Vibhishan, Vibhishan requested Lord Brahma, please bless me that I will follow the righteous path even when I am put into greatest of difficulties, he said. Because generally in this world it is seen even a man of character loses character when he is put in a very difficult situation. Like sometimes a man may be a man of character, but he will steal or loot when there is a very great need for money for some emergency purpose. So you find in this world people do lose their good qualities when they are put into crisis. He said, let me always follow the righteous path even when I am put in a difficult situation. And Brahmaji blessed him, so be it. And actually you will see Vibhishan, even though his brother ditched him, Ravana drove him out, you know, Vibhishan walked the path of God. Later on he went and joined the army of Rama and he became very glorious. Now you will see here, first of all, this Kaikashi is telling Ravana that you do austerities to exceed your brother. Again the same point, austerities are done for the purpose of revenge and not the purpose of revenge, the purpose of envy. So now the envy was created in the heart of Ravana by his mother Kaikashi. At the same time Ravana also had a great greed, excessive greed to overpower his brother and take away his Pushpaka Viman from him. So here comes a very simple point. Austerities in this world are performed by people often to beat down others and climb on their heads. This is one of the reasons for which people do. Or people do out of anger when they want to take revenge against somebody. They perform austerities like that. It has been observed in this world. Therefore, such austerities are useless. Those austerities which don't lead one to Krishna. Aradito yadi hari tapasa tatakyam. Na aradito yadi hari tapasa tatakyam. It is said that if na like aradito yadi hari tapasa tatakyam. If you are already worshipping Krishna, you are rising in the morning, chanting his names, studying Srimad Bhagavatam, you are worshipping the Lord, and all your activities you are connecting to the Lord, you don't have to do severe austerities. Like what Hiranyakashipu did or what Ravana did and such kinds of austerities and tormenting your body, torturing your body. The life of a Vaishnava devotee is much different from the life of these jnanis and yogis. The jnanis and yogis, they torture their senses and torture their mind to control by putting five fires around them in summer and things like that. The Vaishnava devotees, because they are free from both bhukti and mukti, they don't desire material enjoyment, nor do they desire liberation from suffering. Rather, they are ready to be put anywhere the Lord wants to put them, and they simply want to extend loving service to the Lord. So if Lord gives them good food, they will eat. If Lord gives them simple food, they will eat that. If the Lord keeps them as a millionaire, they will be a millionaire and use all money in Krishna service. Lord keeps them as a beggar, like Sudama Brahman was poor, they will be very happy in rendering service to the Lord. So the their bhakti is not situation specific. Their bhakti, they will practice in all situations, in all circumstances, in all time, place, situations. It is not. Therefore, the devotees of the Lord are known for engaging in devotion service in all situations. Prahlad was troubled in so many ways, but he was continuing his devotional service. There are no material impediments for devotional service. Therefore, in this verse, he is saying that Shrutena tapasa vakyam. So that's about tapasa. Then regarding Shrutena, regarding the learning, the Vedic education, Prabhupada is saying, what is the use of learning if one doesn't come to the essence of all learning, which is Vedeshcha Sarvair Ahameva Vedyo. In that connection, Prabhupada is saying, in India, there are many good reciters of Ramayana, Srimad Bhagavatam. They recite the shlokas in a very sweet meter. Or sometimes they present with upama, with like for example, they also present examples and analogies and different types of metaphors and similes. They present in such a way that audience will clap hands. The audience will be impressed with their examples and analogies and the stories that they will give, which are very rare and not commonly known to the people, and they can present very impressively, but at the same time, they are never devotees of the Supreme Lord, he is telling. So their goal is actually gain popularity or make some money out of professional recitation. So when Prabhupada was in America, Prabhupada, in one of the dialogues I was reading, he says that in America, some of the churches had sent their priests to go to the hospital to take treatment for having drunk too much liquor. They had drunk too much liquor, too much smoked, they had got health issues, and they were admitted in the hospitals. So what would happen in the West is, every Friday they were given break. You can go and you can drink, you can smoke, you can do whatever you want. Other 6 days you are supposed to perform your priesthood. And for the priesthood also they were given some salary also. So Prabhupada said, this is completely unacceptable. You know, you are giving salary for the priests and you are giving them freedom to break the regulative principles. You are doing all this, why? Otherwise you won't get people to stay in the temple, in the church for you. So Prabhupada said, according to the Bhagavata, actually we need people who can be renounced, who can be detached, who actually dedicate their life fully for Lord's service. They don't have any other goal to be achieved materially in this world. And Prabhupada said, those people who do that, they can be completely transparent. They can actually study the scriptures and speak the scriptures transparently without adulterating it for any other purpose. Prabhupada was telling that in our ISKCON we are making many such devotees, hundreds and thousands of people who are coming and dedicating their lives as brahmacharis and grihasthas. They are actually working for Krishna. They are dedicating their lives for Krishna. They have full conviction that Krishna is their master, Krishna is their mother, father, be all and end all, everything for them. And they are following the four regulative principles. So, therefore, you will see that if a person who has no material goal, he recites Bhagavatam, there will be purity in that. That, like the verse says, Nivritta tarshai rupagiyamanat bhavaushadat shrotra manobhiramat kavuttama shloka gunanuvadat puman virajyeta vinapashugnat. Is telling, Nivritta tarshai means one who is free from material desires. Like if a person is reciting the Srimad Bhagavatam for making money, they keep 5 lakh rupees, 10 lakh rupees, some professional charges, you know. Then he has to dance according to the tune of the organizers, to please them, to pamper them, because they are giving him some donation. Although some of them say that I take donation for Goshala, I take donation for this service, that service, but when they fix an amount, that if you want me to come there and do the katha, you have to give me 10 lakhs, 5 lakhs, then that money controls them. So, many of them maintain their livelihood by making money. That is one of the professional reciters. And also, another thing Prabhupada says here, that thoughtful writers. Now, Vedavyas is also a writer. But Vedavyas is a literary incarnation of Krishna himself. So, he is very transparently putting down everything. 5,000 years ago, he put down everything in writing so that the Kali Yuga Jivas will have all the Vedas available for him. But then, after Vedavyas, there are also many great writers. There is a saying in English, pen is mightier than the sword, it is said. Why? Because with sword you can kill some people. But certain people wrote certain papers, just 2-3 pages one fellow wrote. And based on those 2-3 pages, a whole country had a big war. You can kill millions of people based on those 2-3 writings, which, like you must have heard about a speech given by certain big leaders, isn't it? Abraham Lincoln or Winston Churchill, the people like that, you will see. They gave a short speech, but even Subhash Chandra Bose also gave. He said that, you know, how many of you are willing to die? We don't want people to come who are eager for eating and eager for sleeping. We want people who are willing to lay down their lives. So they spoke so powerfully. Just a few words, 5 minutes they must have spoken, and a nation with 5 lakh people was ready to dedicate their lives for the war. So some people are thoughtful speakers or writers. They are very mighty in their writing, that it shakes up and wakes up a whole civilization of people. Prabhupada also saw that the communism was spreading all over the world simply by pamphlets and small booklets it was reaching, and therefore Prabhupada wanted to make books and reach out to the people. So, but again the same point, but these so-called thoughtful writers, if they don't come to the conclusion which Vedavyas is coming, Vedeshya Sarvai Ahamebhi Vedyo, then what is the use of that writing, is asking. So, there are many writers nowadays who have a big dilemma now, even in the field of religion. What is the dilemma? If you dilute the message, a mass of people are ready to accept your writing. And if you present the pure message, only very few people are for it. Just like Prabhupada said, the Shuddha Ghise Banaya Hua Laddu, and recycled oil se Banaya Hua Laddu, two types of laddus. A laddu made of Shuddha Ghee is 25 rupees per laddu. And a laddu made of recycled oil is only 5 rupees. And both of them look alike. And they are kept in two separate bottles. Which one people will go for, most people? They want 5 rupee laddu, they want. Although the 5 rupee laddu they will go and eat, and the throat will be spoiled, karakarakara. And you know, their stomach is going to be spoiled. Still people want cheap. Very cheap. And if you give Shuddha Ghee se Banaya Hua Laddu, pure laddu, that people don't want, because they say, who will pay the price? So, therefore, in writing, nowadays, there is something called spirituality without religion. Without bringing God, religion, they are saying spirituality, where they say, you know, just be good, do good, be kind, share and enjoy, you know, don't hurt others, you know, don't interfere with others. Business. Even if a professor is smoking cigarette and drinking liquor and having illicit connections with his students, no problem, as long as he is teaching good, you know, he is teaching the subject good, you should just see the subject, don't see his character. So Prabhupada is talking in one of the morning walks, what nonsense is this? Prabhupada says, a teacher has to be an example. A teacher, if a teacher is smoking, drinking and having illicit connection, he cannot be a teacher, he is a cheater, Prabhupada says. So in India, unless you have a character, you cannot be a teacher. Not that the teacher has a black, dark background outside and he comes to the school or college, he is a very expert teacher, he can teach. No, that's not acceptable, Prabhupada says. Prabhupada says, our Gurukula, Prabhupada says, should have teachers who are teachers of very high character. They should be recruited based on their character, not based on their skill or talent. Prabhupada says, so somebody may be a thoughtful speaker or a writer but has no character. He's a useless fellow. Or he's a thoughtful writer or a speaker, he doesn't come to the right conclusion. You know, Vedasya Sarve Rahamavya Vedyo. Krishna is all that is. He doesn't come to the right conclusion. All his writing and speaking and thinking is simply a colossal waste of time for the living entities. Because he has hijacked the living entities away from the goal for which all the living entities are anxious to attain, which is Krishna's lotus feet. So, therefore, he is talking about vachobihi and chitta vrittibihi. Thoughtful writers and who are the creative philosophers? Pantastu koti shatavatsara sampragamyo vayo ratapi manaso munipungavanam sopyastiyat prapadasimya vichintya tatve govindam adipurusham tamaham bhajami. See, in this verse Brahma says, Pantastu koti shatavatsara sampragamyo. He is saying that koti shata means, koti means crore, shata means 100. There are sages, they are not munis, they are muni pungava. Punga means leaders of the munis. There are leaders of the munis who have the ability to stretch their mind and go travel to any part of the universe at the speed of mind. They can very easily reach. But even after meditating like that, these fellows are only able to see the shining toenail of Krishna. That's all. Nothing beyond that. They see the Brahma Jyoti, effulgence of Krishna from that coming from toenail of Krishna. And they cannot understand anything about the personality of Krishna or the qualities of Krishna or the exchanges of Krishna with his devotees. On the contrary, as opposed to these rishis and munis, there are covered boys who are on an equal level with Krishna, playing with him in the pastures of Vrindavan, joking with Krishna, eating with Krishna. Like that famous verse says, Ittam satam brahma sukhanu bhutya dasyam gatanam paradaivatena maya shritanam naradarakena sakam vijar hukrata punya punjaha. He says, Sukadeva Goswami says, Ittam satam brahma sukhanu bhutya. These great rishis munis are only able to get brahma sukham from the toenail of Krishna. Whereas these boys, covered boys, they are all becoming friends of Krishna, dancing with Krishna, playing with Krishna, eating with Krishna, because they are lovers of Krishna. They are devotees of Krishna. So, if a great Munipungava, a creative philosopher, is not able to take you to the association of Krishna, what is the use of being his follower? That is the point. In this way, then lastly Prabhupada is talking about Buddhya Nipunaya. Very intelligent scientists, but the busy intelligent scientists, their intelligence is engaged in doing what? In creating bombs and destroying people, like putting in Hiroshima, Nagasaki, or you know, creating a dynamite and killing the people. Recently, I met one gentleman. He said he is a leader of a group of scientists working with an organization where they are arranging weapons for the future, which are all aimed at different continents and countries across the globe. And they know that where have the other countries kept their weapons, that also you can find out through satellite communication. They found out. Then he said, you know where they have kept, they know where you have kept, then what is the fun? He said, yes, because if war comes, whoever leads first will win. He said, and we will actually put our weapons in their place of weapons. And they will try to put their weapons in our place of weapons, because you have to go to the root from where the weapons are coming. Because if you finish the root, then other places there are no weapons much. So he was telling. So every country is preparing weapons. Prabhupada said the communists and capitalists both have bombs, and they are not self-controlled sages. Anytime they are going to put the bombs, he said. So advancement in science and technology, you know, over a period of time, you began with killing a mosquito with electric bat. Then you killed the cockroach with the Bagon spray. Then eventually, then they found out ways to kill the humans with atomic bombs. Now there are more dangerous and cheapest of the weapons, which are biological weapons. which are chemical weapons and biological weapons. Chemical weapon means you send a postal parcel to a million people and they all get it. They open their cover on the face. The chemical comes and hits on them, on the spot they die. So there are chemical weapons like that. They may not know what is inside the packet. Then there are biological weapons like the viruses and bacteria. You first of all invent them. Invent them means you discover them in the lab and find out what all effect they can create, poisonous effect in others' bodies. Then you throw them on a large scale on a country where these viruses can spread and multiply and kill big number of people. So these are very cheap ways of killing people and very mean-minded ways and cruel ways, which are extremely sinful because all are large children all across the globe. But if people become envious of the other living entities and they mend ways and means, they may, like he says here, buddhya nipunaya. Buddhya nipunaya means one may be very expert in one's intelligence, but he is using his intelligence to destroy the living entities. Just like the eagle goes sky high and from there he is watching down. But what does he watch? He is watching a dead corpse. That's the use of his eyes. Just see. Prabhupada is saying, when some people were trying to go to moon, when they were flying up, they were saying, here is my country, Moscow or whatever they were saying. People think my land, my motherland. Everybody is attached to their motherland and they want to destroy the other people in the world. So in this way, the low class mentality of killing one another, if that is what is promoted by buddhya nipunaya, by intelligence, then what is the use of such intelligence? Actually, the intelligence should be utilized for studying the subtlest of the knowledge, which is the Vedic literature, especially Srimad Bhagavatam. And that should actually bring one to the point of seeing the soul and super soul in every body. And then one develops affection for all the jivas as God's children, and I am also their brother and sister. Everybody is my brother and sister, and then all are God's children, and Krishna is the father, aham bija pradha pita. When one gets, it's called love agape, they call it. It's a oceanic love. One develops towards all living beings and towards God. Love God, love all. That is the platform. The intelligence is supposed to bring one to. And that is called spiritual intelligence. So if intelligence is not engaged for a spiritual purpose, it's engaged for a material purpose, then what is the use of such a thing? Expert scientific analysis and endeavors are all useless, he says, if it doesn't bring them to the lotus feet of Krishna. And therefore, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur said that when he met, when both of them met, he and our Prabhupada met, he told, there has never been in the past, or there will never ever a time be in the future when you will have any person like Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his followers, he said. Na bhuto na bhavishyati, he said. You will never find. Why? Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught a philosophy which is most, the purest of the philosophy, which brings about the ultimate good for every living being. Because he taught the jivas how not to hurt any other jivas. And simply be satisfied with God-given gifts. And always 24 hours be engaged in Kirtaniya Sadahari. Engaged in Lord's service. Never hurt or harm any other living being. Always be an epitome of love. And spread love. And do good to all by distributing them the holy name. Oneself taking the holy name and distributing the holy name to all the jivas. And bring about universal brotherhood with a common supreme father Krishna in the center. So he said there has never been a religion so universal, so all-encompassing, so all-inclusive of all religions of the world. So he said the way he presented to our Prabhupada, Abhay Charan was completely satisfied. Therefore, he became a dedicated disciple of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur and he expanded the mission worldwide. So therefore, here Narada Muni is telling the Prachetas, Shutena tapasa vakim vacho vischitta vritti bihi buddhya vakim nipunaya balanendriya radhasa. Without devotional service, What is the meaning of severe austerities? The process of hearing, power of speech, power of mental speculation, elevated intelligence, strength, and the power of the senses. If all of them are not utilized in Krishna service, what is the use? So which means, by asking this rhetorical question, what he is saying is that all these things should be utilized in Krishna service. And that's a conclusion. Idam yivam tas tapasashrutasya va swishtasya suktasya ca buddhidattayo avichito artha kavibir nirupito yaduttama shloka gunanu varnanam. He is saying, idam yivam tas tapasashrutasya va. That verse is opposite. That means, Shruti, you are hearing Shrutasya va, and then Swishtasya, Suktasya, Chabuddhi Dattayo. You are performing Yajna, you are reciting the Suktas like, Purusha Sukta and all the Suktas. Buddhi Dattayo, so you have a great intelligence. Or you want to give charity. What you should do? Avichyuto Varta Kavivir Nirupito. It should all be done for only the pleasure of Lord Achyuta, Lord Krishna only. Adottama shloka gunanu varnanam. It should be utilized for glorification of the Supreme Lord. There is another verse also like this, which Shukadeva Goswami recites while offering his invocation prayers. In that he tells, he says, tapasvino dana parayashasvino manasvino mantravido sumangala kshemam na vindanti vinaya darpanam tasmai subhadra shravase namo namaha. You know what he is saying? Tapasvino, if you are a tapasvi, do tapasya for Krishna's pleasure. Dana para, one who is a great charitably disposed man. Yashasvino, one who is very popular man. Mantravido, one who is a very great chanter, very great reciter of the Vedic chant. Sumangala means people who bring about auspiciousness to others. Kshemam na vindanti vinaya darpanam. None of these people can attain perfection in their life without offering all these things to that Supreme Lord. Tasmai Subhadra Shravase Namo Namaha. That Subhadra is the most auspicious Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. All these talents and skills and capabilities should be offered in His glorification. So this couple of verses I told you now, and that is actually the summary understanding of this verse today. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. Thank you very much.